Okay, hello everyone. So today I'm going to be talking about and showing you a bit about fashion drawing. I've been drawing fashion for forever. It's when I studied at uni, but also I've just always been really interested in it. So it's kind of what I drew as a kid as well. But I'm going to talk about different things I use, whether it be different mediums or different like books and stuff that I think helped me to create better sketches and everything. So I think I might have to split this into two videos. The first one will be talking about more of what I use and different types of like sketching I do, and then the other one will probably be more for a true fashion illustration and show you how to do that, because I did have a how to do a fashion figure video up here, but it was made like at least like 2 years ago or so, and my style's changed a bit and the quality of the video is not the greatest, so I thought I would redo that as well. So the first thing to do is decide what kind of sketch you want to make. So whether it be a true fashion illustration, which is like a proper, really nicely done, focusing on kind of the whole image, not just the garment, not just the figure, kind of the whole thing. I'll try to put like a picture or two over here to kind of get the idea of what I'm talking about. So that is a lot more of an intense type of thing, and that generally you won't be coming up with the ideas when you're doing that. That will be the final stage. That's after you've done all the things, you've maybe even sewn the piece. It's more there as an illustration, it's there just to look at. Or whether you're wanting to make a fashion sketch. So fashion sketch is more, you've come up with an idea in your head and you want to get it down on paper quickly, or you're wanting to make something, you're not sure what, maybe you've got the fabric, maybe it's for a project or something, so it's kind of a little bit rougher, not focusing so much on the whole image. It might just have a few details in it, or it might have a lot of detail but not really care about the figure. It's more about creating the actual garment. So obviously I work mostly with fashion sketches because I design. So I usually keep fashion illustrations for things I've had to do for uni, or if I just want a fun little thing to draw. But I am going to talk about a few things that I think helped me create fashion sketches first. So the first thing is these books. So this is a Fashionary book, and this one doesn't actually have a name on it, so I don't know what the company is, but I will try to find it, or at least a similar one. I got this in New York just because I didn't bring my Fashionary away and I wanted something to quickly sketch in. So both of these books have figures drawn on them. You might not be able to see it in the lens because it is really, really faint, and they all also have, this one has perforated edges so you can like tear it out, which is really, really handy. So I find this most useful when I have already got a fabric, or I've got something in mind and I'm like, oh, I really want to get that down quickly before I forget about it, so I can just put it down and not have to worry about drawing the figure. So this one comes with some information on like garments and fashion terms. If you're new to fashion, that might be really helpful for you when you're reading different blogs or when you're hearing people talk about it. So if I open it up, so like this one, so I had this fabric I was trying to work out what to do with, so I've just gone ahead and drawn some quick sketches onto the croquis already there. It's also got double-sided pages, which means it's not really great for coloring or anything because it will bleed through, but it is really good for just a quick gray lead sketch. So as you can see, this one, which is upside down probably, this one I did Copic marker over the top and it bled through a lot, but I mean it's still good if you want to test it out and you're not worried about losing the other side of the page. So like in these ones, as you can see here, I haven't drawn the full figure even. I've just wanted to get the idea for the garment down. So I've drawn that out and then maybe drawn in a little bit of the neckline, something to give a bit of reference, and that is all I wanted. So I really like these books for that kind of quick sketch, or you've already got the idea, you've got the fabric or something, and you just want to get it down. These also, when you scan them, because they're so lightly drawn, the croquis, it won't show through when you scan it. So that's really helpful. Also, if you are getting into maybe CAD drawings or anything like that, that'll be really good because you can easily have the pose already set out and you can go and test out coloring things. And I found that really helpful because so often I want to test out maybe a new coloring technique or something and I just don't end up having a good idea to test out on. But when you've already got the pose and everything set up for you, it's a lot easier. I also like these because, like this one, I've got these fabrics that I want to use up and I have a vague idea in my head of what I want to do, but I kind of need that visual so that when I go and make the pattern for it and everything, I know exactly what I'm doing. So as you can see here, I've done this trench coat, and because the figure's already there, I've not had to do a like drawing underneath. The page is really clean and I've been able to do quite a detailed drawing, stitching lines and everything. So I definitely think these are really great, especially if you're starting out, you're not very good at drawing figures yet. It will help you get proportions right, it will help you get a pose without having to think one up. I also like the Fashionary because it is quite small. It's probably, I think it's A5 sized, and I can fit this in my handbag. When I was at uni, I would often carry this around and then do little sketches if I thought of something for the semester's collection. This one has it drawn in as dots instead of like a faint line, but they're still really like light and you can't see it so much when you scan it in. It doesn't have the perforated edges, which I probably don't like as much because I do like being able to tear it out and pin it up somewhere, but it's still a good way to just get some ideas down, get a quick sketch. As you can see, all of these have just been done in pencil or pen really quickly with some little annotations to get the ideas out. And that would also be the other thing, is always annotate your things, even if you know in your head, like, oh no, that's obviously a pleat, or that's obviously something, whatever. You might forget, and when you come back to it, you might be like, oh, I really like that design, but what was I gonna do there? So I think that's always helpful. And also, if you're going to be applying for university with any sketches from these folios or anything like that, they'll probably expect to see that, and it will help other people understand your drawings too. But yeah, so same kind of thing I did in the other book. I also like this one because it has a little date and I can kind of like keep it in my head what I had at that time. It also has a whole glossary at the front of different techniques, different meanings of things. So again, that can be really helpful if you are new and you want to kind of get an idea. It's got a few templates. So both of these are really good and I'll try to link them down below. You can also get the Fashionary men's, so if you're into menswear, you can definitely get it there. Okay, so the next way is very similar to these other two, where you will already have that figure set out for you and it's super easy to do, and it's printing out a figure that you find online. Obviously, if you're gonna do this, you can't sell these images or claim them as your own because you are technically copying the figure. But it's really handy if you just want a quick sketch and just make it really simple and easy. So you can either do this two ways, and I'll put some sort of like footage over the top here showing you. So you can use a light box. Now, light boxes can be pretty expensive and you won't always be able to get one, so I completely understand that. You can also put it up against a window and put a little piece of paper over the top, and then you can trace it really easily. That's a really great way to do this. Again, just to get that sketch out, if that's what you want to do. If you're not focusing so much on what the figure is, you just want a figure so you can put your drawing on top of it, this is a really great way to do that. Yeah, so you can use a light box or a window. Or there's another little trick which I have learned, and if you trace over it with a pencil that's pretty soft, you can use an HB if you want, but I'd probably go more a 2B or something darker. If you trace over the figure with that and then you put it face down on the paper so that the lead is touching the paper, and then on the other side you probably will be able to faintly see the line of the figure, and trace over that again, it will leave a slight imprint of the lead on that paper and you have a slight outline. I use this all throughout uni in my books because I had really, really thick watercolor paper in my folio, and I found this so helpful to just give me a really quick figure so I could just make my sketch on top that I already had in my head. So yeah, that's a really quick and easy technique. And like I said, if you're just wanting to put your image down, you just have that design in your head and you don't want to lose it, these are really great to just get it out there without worrying too much about making sure you have a figure that's proportionate, making sure all of that is okay. Okay, other than that, you can just sketch freely. That is often what I do. I will just have a sketchbook like this. I like getting one with a little higher quality paper because then I can put some sort of like color and marker over it without worrying too much about bleeding or anything. And again, I'll put some like footage over the top. So you should be really free with these types of drawings. I think that's the best way to go about it. You can make things really creative that way, and you never know what kind of designs are going to come. Often if I'm stuck for a design, I'll just begin freehand sketching with no figure, nothing underneath, and I'll just make like a few lines and kind of think like, oh, that's sort of a neckline, let's add something else to it, let's make it something more. And sketching like this is really, really important because it gets the ideas flowing, and you don't even have to sketch a full fig, you don't have to sketch a full garment, or even it can just be like, oh, I think this sleeve would be interesting, I think that would be interesting. And that's what my teachers always told me at uni, and it's something that's really stuck with me, is that you don't have to have that full idea yet. If you have part of it, you can then work out the rest later. And so I think it's really important to have that freehand sketching to do that. So when I'm freehand sketching, I do usually like to have some sort of figure. I think that's just convention for me, and it helps me sort of keep something that it's a garment in mind. So I'll usually start with the head, and then I'll do the neck and shoulders, and then do the rest from there. Often with just like literally lines as an arm and like some sort of blob for the elbow and knees, so I know sort of like, oh, I want that to be this length. And they're never really super proportionate, as you probably can see if I have edited something over the top, I hope I have. Then, you know, they're not proportionate, they're nothing that can probably be very easily explained to someone without a creative eye, but they're very good as a start off. And then from there you can go and then get your proper figure and refine the drawing down so you can easily tell, oh yeah, I want this to look like this, I want the stitching lines to be here, there should be a pocket here, and you can more easily tell. But as the first kind of sketch, as the first creative idea, I think just go for it. If things are out of proportion, things may not look perfect, then that's okay. It just kind of gets that idea out there in a really creative way. But I'm going to show you some mediums that I use when just even sketching. Some of these I will also bring into doing fashion illustrations. So the most basic thing I use are just plain grey lip pencils. So I use this, what's it called? Palomino Blackwing 502. And you might have, if you read heaps of like art blogs and things, you might have heard of this one already. I really like it. It's really soft lead and quite dark, but when I'm doing a bit of shading and kind of finished off the sketch, I will use this one. It's really good because it's so dark, it will be able to get those lines really sharp. I usually start sketching with one of these, which is, this one's an F and this one's an H. They're just really light, so when I'm beginning to sketch, if I mess up, I don't have to really worry about having made the page too dirty or anything like that. So these, this one's a Faber-Castell, this one's, I don't know the brand, Roymac. I got this one for like school, I think, and like we got a new set each year, so I have like a million of them. So these are great too. And then just an HB pencil as well. I kind of use the lighter ones, then I use an HB, and then I get to the darker one. The HB again, just because it's a bit darker than these two, can be better when I've kind of finished out the proper lines I want, and a little bit of shading as well. This, I just got like a box of about like a billion from Officeworks. So yeah, I think any HB pencil is fine. I don't really have too much of a preference over type of pencil. The only pencil I've noticed like a big difference when I'm using is this one. Yeah, this one's really quite different to the rest. Also in that bundle, a sharpener. I like these ones that like kind of like hide away, because then if I'm putting it in a pencil case, it doesn't get dirty because the lint doesn't get everywhere. And then this little razor, this razor I have about a million of. It's the, oh, what's the brand name? I've completely forgotten the brand name. It begins with an M and it's a softy one. And you can get them like in bigger ones than this and smaller ones. I like the smaller ones, I don't know, because I just do. But this is the only razor I use. I hate all of the razors after using this one, so if that's any help to you. But I mean, I know heaps of other people don't like this razor and like other ones, so like all art tools, use what you want because that's probably gonna be the best for you. Next thing I used to use all the time, and now I'm kind of trying to stray away from them, at least when I'm illustrating, because I think illustrations often look quite nice without lines around them. But it's fine liners. I think these are really handy. I mean, I did just say I'm trying to stray away from using them in illustrations, but I still do. I do like the look of illustrations without any fine lines around them, but there is a place in my heart for fine liners. And when I'm sketching, these are great because, like I said, with the pencils, often I choose a darker one to go over the lines, but that will smudge and stuff like that. So sometimes I'll go over with a fine liner instead if I'm really sure of that's the shape I want, those are the lines I want. I'll go over with this. These are the Artline ones. It goes from 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5, and then 0.8. I'll usually stick below 0.5. And 0.8 maybe just for like a really thick outline if I want that kind of look, but usually I won't go up that heavy. I'll stick with the smaller ones. If you like small lines as well, the Copic fine liners are really, really good, and they go down to like a 0.01 or something, but be very careful with them. I am someone who presses really hard when I draw, and I know I shouldn't, but it's just how I draw. I have a really heavy hand, and I killed mine, so I am so annoyed with that. But they're really good if you want that really, really fine line. And often when you're doing fashion drawings, if you want to get into that little like stitching details, they can be so great because they're just that extra bit thinner. The next thing I use a lot is my watercolors. So I've got this Winsor & Newton one, which I got in like a whole set with like a bunch of other things in it, and it was on sale. And I love these. I've been looking at buying a set like this for so long. So when I saw it was on sale and it came with like a few other paints, it came with a masking fluid and a couple of brushes, I was like, yep, I'm getting it, definitely, this is for me. But if you're new to watercolor, I wouldn't get one of these just because they are a little bit pricey. You can instead get this little thing. They sell these pretty much everywhere. This is Koh-i-Noor. I probably butchered that name. I'll try to link it down below. I'll probably link it at my local art store because that's the one I know, but you can always just Google the name and you should be able to find one selling at your art store. So it comes in like these little discs, and I use this for when I'm mixing the colors. So I do like this one because it comes with lots of color options, and as you can see, some of them I have like completely butchered, like this poor little gray. And yeah, it's a really great way to start out doing watercolors. I really love this. They're definitely not the best watercolors in the world. The Winsor & Newton ones are definitely a step up, but if you're just getting started and you want to practice, these are really great. And I also really like watercolors for fashion sketching, because when you are fashion sketching, I think often you don't want to do a full thing of color. It's just like a little slither, so you know, oh, that's going to be green, that's going to be blue, whatever. So watercolor is really good for that, because you can just put a little swipe of it next to it and that will kind of give a good indication. So these are the tools I use when doing my watercolor. I have this little tray which actually came with the Winsor & Newton pack that I got, where I mix the colors, and mine's completely dirty because it just always is and I probably need to clean it. And I have a little sponge which I don't use too much. As you can see, I've got a little bit, but I don't really use it that much when I'm doing fashion illustrations, just because I usually don't need it and I'm not doing anything really big enough for this anyway. Then these are all my brushes. As you can see, I've got one which is marked as my masking fluid brush, and that's because it is completely hard and gross, because I don't know how to clean masking fluid off a brush. I have looked it up and I've tried every way and I just can't And to be honest, it's fine just like putting it on with this. And again, I don't really necessarily use it too much for fashion illustration. It can be good if you're not particularly good at painting in the lines, just putting like a little bit around the outside. Or if you want to cover up like place where like a buckle's gonna go, or a really light color and you're currently painting with a dark color, you can put it on to make sure it doesn't bleed out. My favorite brushes are probably this one, which is a Winsor & Newton. It says number 4 round artist watercolor sable. This one came with the pack as well. I really like this brush handle because it's kind of got this like out and in and out shape, and they're just so soft and gorgeous. I love these. The other I have that I really love are these ones. I have a few of these. So this is a 6, this is a 5, and this is the round, what is it? Robert A. Wade Neef Talcon Round. So that's a 5 and 6. I just really like these. I think they're super soft and they're round, so they kind of come to a little bit of a tip at the end when you want to put on just like a little touch of color. I also always have a really small brush at hand. So this one is the same as that round 000. So it's super, super tiny and just can get those little details, which I really find perfect. These bigger brushes that are in here I don't really use for fashion illustrations. They're just a little bit too large. Unless I'm doing some sort of really wide skirt or something, then I might want to use them. They don't actually have a brand name on them. This one's a number 16, kind of shaped like this. I do like this one. If I'm going to be doing like a really big like ball gown skirt or something, this is good to get that wash of color, and because it does have the point, I can kind of like paint down to a point to make it have a nice little tip at the end. But yeah, those are the brushes I mostly use, and I just keep them in this little jar thing. Okay, the other thing I use a lot of when I'm doing fashion illustration is Copic markers. I have the 72A colors. You can get a few different types of colors, and these are very expensive, I will warn you. This was actually my brother's, and then he never used it, so he ended up giving it to me, which was very, very lovely, because a pack of these will set you back over $300. So keep that in mind if you are interested in these. I would probably go to the store, test them out. You can also get cheaper versions of markers like this. So maybe do a little bit of research into them and try out a few of them, see if you even like drawing with markers. You can also buy these separately, which is really nice. I have a few ones that I've added onto this, which I've bought separately because I've done a different color scheme to what I have here and I need those extra colors. I also bought a few skin tones to add to this because this pack doesn't really have too many skin tones that I like or anything. Like the sand is probably the best one, and the like wire 00 is the closest you really get to any sort of flesh color. But I really, really like these. I think if you want to get a pack of Copics to start with, you can buy these boxes separately. So you can always buy a box and kind of start getting them slowly. They're about $10 each. So if you want to buy like a few to begin with, you can slowly add to them. Maybe like if you buy, I don't know, one each month, that's $10 each month, and then by the end you'll have 12. I would definitely start with getting some greys. The greys kind of use to darken the colors. So depending on what kind of colors you're working with, I've got cool greys and warm greys, but you can also get tonal greys and neutral greys. So maybe get a neutral grey if you're not sure if you're mostly working with warm colours or cold colours. And then maybe get a blue, like a red, a pink kind of colour, a green, a yellow. If you get kind of basic primary colours, you can always blend them, because that's how Copics work. You can draw them over each other. That's how you can create really good shading with them, by putting the greys over the top and putting other colours over top of each other. So they are really good for that. Also, if you're going to be using these, I would suggest getting some sort of bleed proof. I don't always use bleed proof with this, but if you're going to be mixing colors or anything like that, or if you're new to them, so you're not going to be used to how much they do bleed, because they do bleed a little bit, then that'll probably be good because it doesn't really soak into the paper as much, which means you have more time to blend different colours and you'll get used to the feel of them better that way. Next thing I was talking about was pencils. I use watercolour pencils just because you can use them as completely normal pencils, and then also if you want to just add a little bit of water and turn it into a watercolour. Like I was saying before, often with fashion sketches I just want to add a little slither of colour to them, so this can be really good for that because you can just draw a couple of lines and then go over it with some water and wash it out. I really like this set. It's from Faber-Castell, finest artist quality watercolour pencils. I can't say that name because it looks like it's German or something, but I'm not going to even try because I'm going to butcher that. I really love these. This is a 60 pack, so it's got two trays of colours. I absolutely adore these pencils. I should use them more, but I just never want to use them up. Oh, that made a bad sound. You can get these from Officeworks, I believe, individually. I've seen them there. But you can also get them from art stores, and you can get them in much smaller boxes than this. I just wanted to use this many colours. I think the colour range in these are really good. And I think colour pencils are something you'd probably have at home because they're something that kids use. And even if you're using that kind of quality and you're not using a full artist quality, it's a really, really great place to start. And it's a good way to just get a little bit of colour into your sketches. And it also gets a little bit of dimension. Unlike markers, where if you have that one colour, that's kind of it. You have to go over it a few times to get a bit of shading. And even then, it really only gets to one colour. You have to have another marker to make it a little bit darker, anything like that. Whereas with coloured pencils, or like grey lead, you can create proper shading with it because you can press really lightly and then go a lot harder and go over it a few times to make it darker. So they're a really good, easy way to add dimension to your drawings. Okay, I hope you enjoyed this. I'm going to make another video, which should be up only shortly after this one, showing you how I create a fashion illustration. I might do a little bit of CAD stuff in that, I'm not sure yet. I'll see how I feel on the day. And yeah, thanks for watching. Don't forget to comment, subscribe, check out my blog, all of that fun stuff. And yeah, thanks for watching. Bye.